So today, I wanted to talk about a drug, or a family of drugs that is very special to us. And I was wondering if anyone could guess what, from this picture, what I was talking about. What
is it? Poppies.
Yes, poppy, exactly, exactly. Sally thought I was talking about marijuana. This is not Sally. Today I'm going to be talking about opium, or opium derivatives. So, as you guys know, over the past few weeks I've kind of been on a crusade against opiates. So I wanted to take you through that. I thought it would be fun. If not fun, it would be interesting to kind of go over the history of opium and its derivatives. And then I want us to consider reasons why maybe we shouldn't be using opiates, and then also consider a future state that may include less opiates in our practice or no opiates in our practice. So I want you guys just to skim through this quote, and we'll come back to it later on. And it might be a point of discussion for you guys, but I think this really just sets the tone as far as how we see ourselves, kind of, with what we do every day. And I actually just found this from a blog post. So the author did a really great job. I think that this was really poignant. I don't know if you agree, but. So humans have known about opiates and the ability of opiates to relieve pain and the ability of opiates to induce euphoria for a very long time. As far as written history is concerned, it dates back all the way to about 3400 BC to a land known as Mesopotamia. And this land would come under rule by many different groups, but this was a very important place. This was a very fertile land. It's the land of very important human advancements, which included the invention of the wheel and the development of language and the development of written language and the development of mathematics. And the use of drugs. So this extends to the Greeks and Romans around 300 BC, and we're all familiar with Hippocrates. Hippocrates was said to have employed opium to treat internal diseases and epidemics and diseases of women, which is so funny because he probably just meant disease. But and about a century later, and thousands of miles away, the Chinese were also using opium. They were using opium in a concoction with indica, or weed, perioperatively. So that's pretty cool. The next point that I wanted to share with you, so around 1300 AC, this is when opium actually disappears from European history for about 200 years. And this is the time of the Inquisition, and that's because anything that was associated with the East, opium was associated with the East, it was linked to the devil. But I thought this point was really interesting as well because it seemed like the first instance of an authoritative entity acknowledging the negative implications of opium in society and how detrimental addiction and withdrawal could be to your society. So around 1500 AC, so 200 years later, opium returned as a preparation known as laudanum. It was basically opium with alcohol, and this was very important at the time. Obviously, you may recall, in the 1500s, all the explorations to the Americas, a lot of these settlements were kind of stricken by cholera and dysentery and smallpox, and so opium was very, very important at the time. I'm assuming it could have been life-saving as well in the instances of diarrheal illnesses. So it was very important to America at that point. The next time, or the next year, that we have really medical advancements with opium is in 1806. And at this point, there was a German chemist who isolated the active ingredient of opium, and he named it morphine after God of Dreams, Morpheus. And I think this is Morpheus. There aren't many images of him. I'm assuming it's him because he's wearing a crown of poppies that he probably used to drug people. So that's and then by the middle of that century in America, in the United States, morphine was very heavily relied upon. And then in 1843, actually, is when a Dr. Alexander Wood discovered that you could inject morphine and that it was more potent. So they were very excited by that. About 10 years later, they invented the hypodermic needle. So I'm not I don't know how they were administering it before the hypodermic needle, but 10 years later, they invented the hypodermic needle, and then sub-Q really made its debut. And as you could predict, morphine went on to be very important during the Civil War, but it's actually really sad because all of these injured soldiers ended up becoming addicted. So we had this dependent veteran population that had a lot of difficulty kind of assimilating back into society. But that didn't stop drug companies. Like, even in the 19th century, drug companies were really doing the most. So this is a particular formulation, Mrs. Winslow's soothing syrup, and it was marketed to parents, but it was marketed to parents for children. And it was morphine and alcohol, and it was marketed to parents with teething children in particular. So it reads here, "Are you broken in rest by a sick child suffering with the pain of cutting teeth? Go at once to a chemist and get a bottle of Mrs. Winslow's soothing syrup." And this would stay on the shelves until about the 1930s. 1894, very important to pharmaceutical companies. We have a German company known as Bayer that we're familiar with. They essentially added acetyls to morphine, and they invented heroin. And they touted heroin to be this alternative to morphine that was not addictive. And I think they really, believed this, because at some point, where they were able to get, everyone else to believe this, because there were community organizations that were offering samples of heroin in the mail to morphine addicts. And it's funny because some of the ads that I came across, it even said, even if you're not using it for your friend, so if you knew someone who's a morphine addict, you could get them a sample of heroin. And they promised you that it would help you to kick your habit. Which obviously didn't happen, and heroin was taken off the market shortly after. But in 1916, it's kind of like deja vu, there was another German, everything's coming from Germany, there was a German chemical company that synthesized their first opioid. So this is oxycodone. And oxycodone, again, was touted to be the next best thing, to provide analgesia like morphine, but to not be addictive. And despite that not being the case, it was approved by the FDA in the 1950s, and it was basically, the general public had really great access to it, at least by the 1960s. And that coincided with the entrance of Vicodin onto the market. So now at this point, you have all these synthetic opioids flooding shelves, and it really sets us up for a lot of the recreational drug abuse that occurred in the 60s and 70s. And so the response to this, the political response to this in 1971, is this war on drugs, is Nixon's war on drugs. And this is a quote that that was documented. "Heroin addiction is the most socially destructive form of addiction in America at that time." And despite his intentions, I think it's looked at, this war on drugs, which kind of still seeps into our policies today, was kind of looked at as a failure. So one reason why is because they really pushed for complete eradication, which is probably not realistic, it's very extreme. And the other thing is, it led to its exponential rise in incarceration rates. And those incarceration rates and that really affected minority populations mostly, so black communities. And so there was a lot of social unrest at the time. These policies also seemed to be directed towards the anti-war left, who happened to partake in weed use. There was a lot of social unrest. It seems there are a lot of parallels to today. That's kind of where this war on drugs started. In the 1990s, there's a shift, at least in medicine. This term, legal analgesia, finds its way in the medical literature. And so physicians who initially, prior to the 1990s, were apprehensive to prescribe opiates, were now pressured by their colleagues and pressured by the Joint Commission to start prescribing opiates. Which was kind of counterintuitive to them. On top of that, you now had synthetic extended spectrum opiates, including fentanyl and our favorite Dilaudid, entering the marketplace. So the unintentional but very expected consequence of that, of writing more prescriptions, is the increase in drug use. But despite all of that, American Pain Society kind of coined this phrase, pain the fifth vital sign. And I think even to this day, we practice in this way. We're very aggressive with pain management. Maybe because of a lot of these advocacy groups, but we're very, very aggressive. And again, because of that, I think it translated to, I guess you really couldn't stop it from happening, the increase in drug use. So this is a statistic from the CDC. Tomorrow, or today, 44 Americans will die from prescription painkillers. And we're feeling that in the ER, because in the 90s, we would see about 700,000 cases related to drugs, and by now I'm assuming it's closer to 1 million. So at this point, I kind of wanted to go back to this quote. I don't know if anyone wouldn't mind to read it for me.
Sure.
Thank you.
No one can deny the severity of the opioid crisis in which we currently reside. But what is less clear is whether we are innocent bystanders facing the consequences of someone else's problem or directly responsible for causing a portion of the addiction you're currently witnessing.
Thank you. I don't know how you feel about this. I wonder where you think you fall on the spectrum. I wonder where you think we as a department fall on the spectrum. I wonder where you want to fall on the spectrum in the future. But I just wanted this to kind of be a little bit of a brain exercise to move you towards action. Because I could have posted a bunch of articles that point fingers on us, not just as doctors, but as emergency medicine physicians, for our contribution to the opioid problem. And there was one paper in particular that said 2% of prescriptions that are related to opioid deaths can be traced back to the emergency physician. And at first I was like, that's a lot. And then I thought to myself, that's actually not that bad. Like 2%, probably not that bad. And then I started to feel like, I'm not going to take responsibility for that, right? Like, are we going to take responsibility for that just because we use opiates sometimes? Or just because we happen to care for patients who are suffering from opiate-related illnesses? Is that our fault? Maybe that's just because by nature, sometimes it can be a little defensive. But then I thought about our sickle cell population, and I thought to myself, what is my impact on them? So at this point, these are poppies. So at this point, I wanted us to have a little bit of introspection. I think that we can make a difference. I think we can make a difference in this community especially. And I think it starts with your next patient. I think it starts with your next order. And I want us to look at pain and consider an alternative way to treat pain. And at this point, I also want to share with you a patient interaction, a patient encounter that I had. And this kind of, I'm glad that Dan had mentioned, had done his senior lecture on burnout earlier, and how you really need to find a way to connect with your patients, because this really affected me, this particular interaction. And if there's one thing that I learned in my 4 years here, it's how a single patient encounter can really change how you see things. It can change how you are as a doctor. It can just change your being. So this is a story of an individual's circumstances, and I hate to tell this story because it's not my own. They're not my own circumstances, but I asked for permission. So it was just a downstage shift, and I picked up the next sickle cell patient, and what do we always do? I order 6 and 50, and I go see another patient. Right? I come back later, hoping they're ready to go home, and I don't know what it was. Maybe it was a slow day, but I decided to walk over to the patient immediately. And this is actually a patient that I have a soft spot for. She's very sweet. She's very, just very straightforward with you. There's no drama. There's really, she never causes any problems. And I walked over to her and I said, I don't remember exactly what I said. I think I said something along the lines of like, how's life? Which is so mortifying. I feel so embarrassed I even said that to her. Because if you think of our sickle cell patients, and if you were to ask them, how is life? Like, how could life be great for them? They come and see you every day, sometimes multiple times a day. Sometimes they're evading providers. Sometimes they're being stuck, prodded, et cetera, et cetera. And I just felt so embarrassed by asking her that. But I played it off and I excused myself. I was going to go order her medications. And then she asked for a second of my time. She said, Doc, you know, when you get a chance, if you wouldn't mind coming back. And I said, yeah, that's fine, totally. So I went and saw a patient, came back. And I said, hey, what's up? What's going on? And she told me that things weren't going well. And so I was like, okay, is this serious? And I said, well, what's going on? She shared with me that she was looking for a provider. And we kind of know that. We know that people are apprehensive to take care of our sickle cell population. So she was having a hard time finding a provider. She had gone to the pain management clinic at county the day prior, and she waited for hours. Waited for hours, and when it was her turn, and they found out that she was a sickle cell patient, they turned her away. So I felt like kind of embarrassed for her. I could tell in the way that she told me that story that she felt very helpless, and then I felt helpless. So I know that was very touching, but I wanted to encourage her, and I said, well, that's a great thing. I think that's good that you're trying to cut back on your opiate dependence. Like, that's really great for you. And then she shared with me that this is not, it wasn't for her. So she has a daughter, which I didn't know, and her daughter was graduating from the Air Force at the end of March. And this encounter was sometime in February. So I was very happy for her. I was happy that she had a goal. But at the same time, I kind of knew that that wasn't probably going to work out for her. If she couldn't find a provider, there's really no way that she could have been away from our ED, where we basically do dialogue and, you know, maintenance for them. That she probably would never be able to go see her daughter graduate. And so at that moment is really when I, like, you know, at Downstate, everything's going so quickly. Everything was just decelerating for me. And I thought to myself, what am I doing to you, right? Like, every time I order you 6 and 50, and every time I give you your paperwork, and it's just this routine thing, what am I doing to you? So I don't know if any of you have had those experiences, if you sat down to really speak to our sickle cell patients, but, you know, that really affected me. And then I went on my tirade against opiates. So if that just gives you a little bit of an idea of what's going on in my head, I think it's just a reason to consider is what our impact is on our patients. So I don't know if anyone has had any experiences similarly, but aside from like the emotional component, because even if we carry this out and we have a comprehensive plan for our patients, our sickle patients, in a sense, we're treating ourselves. I admit that when I first approached this to have guidelines for patients, I was treating myself because I felt terribly about what we were doing. But aside from that emotional attachment to it, I did want to share with you maybe some other reasons why we should consider using less opiates. So, we're not masters at using it, or using them. This is a study, it was prospective, that was published in the Journal of Opioid Management by an O'Connor, and O'Connor's all over the pain management literature. But it was a prospective study, and it looked at individuals coming to the ER with pain, and it looked at why individuals were receiving Dilaudid versus morphine. And there was really no explanation. It wasn't a pain scale. It wasn't anything in the demographic. It was really arbitrary, the choice between morphine and Dilaudid. And when they went back to interview the providers, they found that there were a lot of misconceptions about the pharmacology of both. There's also no great consensus on how to dose it, whether we should be dosing it fixed or whether we should be dosing it weight-based. You know, we've always been trained to dose weight-based, although with us, our sickle cell population, it becomes kind of routine, but we've always been taught weight-based. But this is a study actually out of Jacoby. It was prospective, and it basically looked at patients of all body weights, and they provided them the same amount of Dilaudid. Everyone got 1 milligram. And so the assumption is that if you're a lighter patient, you have a lower total body weight, you would appreciate an increase in pain reduction. But they didn't find an association. That actually wasn't the case. So this kind of refutes the idea of weight-based dosing, but there's really no great consensus. I don't know if we have a problem with this necessarily, but there was a retrospective study, again, done by O'Connor. It looked at patients receiving analgesia in the ED, on the floors, the surgical floors, and they found that the patients who received Dilaudid, they received a dose that was 6 times the equivalent morphine dose that the morphine patients received, with no explanation. There's no reason. So they're receiving 6 times the amount of potency. I don't think that's really our issue. That's like site-specific, that sounds kind of crazy, but it's just something to consider. And then we're also not titrating appropriately. That's something that I believe happens, actually. So this is this was a review of two RCTs, also from Jacoby. And what they found was patients, regardless of what the patient's pain scale was, whether there was a reduction in their pain scale, it had no correlation to what they received subsequently. And I kind of believe that. So that kind of takes me to a very extreme side of the spectrum. This is the opiate-free ED. Now you may be familiar with Matov, he's at Maimonides. He's a big pain management guy. And the summer of last year, they instituted an opiate-free ED. So I actually really like this slide. It's like, I also like this slide. So essentially his approach to pain is to address different receptors and to address different pathways. And this isn't going to be a comprehensive pharmacology lecture, but I'm going to hit the high points. Ketamine. So I think we're pretty familiar with ketamine, actually. I think we can use it more. Matov loves ketamine. I just stole this from his PowerPoint presentation, actually. He loves ketamine. He loves memes. It's like great. He really loves ketamine. And so we know it acts on the NMDA receptors, right? It's an antagonist. This is the bolus dosing for analgesia that I have used. I know a lot of you, I'm sure, have used as well. It can also be given as a drip. I personally haven't used it as a drip. I think that maybe one time I did it was with an intubated patient, and that's very valid. So if you have an intubated patient and their blood pressure is dropping on fentanyl or what have you, consider starting a ketamine drip for analgesia. The good thing is about ketamine, right? It's a pretty quick onset. It's titratable. Kind of negatives are the adverse drug reactions that we're kind of afraid of. Apnea, which I've seen personally. It wasn't a bad outcome, but I have seen it. Laryngospasm, which I had not seen. And then the emergence reaction. So who are you not going to be giving ketamine to? So Matov cites pregnant women to be an absolute contraindication. There actually isn't, it hasn't been graded yet, but there's some question as to whether or not it can cause neurotoxicity to the fetus. So that's something to consider. Children under 2 years, and then any individual who is maybe actively psychotic, someone who has an Axis 1 diagnosis, I think that makes kind of sense. I don't have an emoji for that. But this is actually Matov's trial. So he looked at, it was prospective randomized. They looked at giving patients ketamine at 0.3 milligrams per kg as a bolus versus morphine. And the outcome being pain reduction at 30 minutes. And at 30 minutes, there was no difference. I think all the patients, both groups, their pain went from about an 8 to a 3 or 4. So it was as effective as morphine, which was nice. And then as far as adverse events are concerned, there were no clinically concerning adverse events. I think there were some participants in the ketamine group that appreciated some dizziness, felt a little disoriented, which maybe isn't the worst thing. And then I wanted to also include this article because Matov and Maimo, they do intranasal ketamine a lot. And I know we do it sometimes in peds, but maybe we should be employing it in adults. But this was also prospective randomized. They used intranasal ketamine at 1 milligram per kilogram versus morphine IV push. And the outcome being onset of pain relief and the degree of pain relief. And they found with those two outcomes there was no difference. Next, I would like to talk about lidocaine. So he's a proponent of regional blocks, and we use lidocaine almost every shift, but this is lidocaine IV. Now, I don't remember, I know I've done it once, and I don't recall when, it might have been my first year, that we injected lidocaine right before giving propofol, because propofol can hurt. So, I don't remember the dose we used. This is the dose. 1 to 1.5 milligrams per kilogram as a bolus, obviously without epi, max 300. So you have a lot of wiggle room. I would just always keep in mind the toxicity of lidocaine, so like periorbital numbness, right, some tinnitus, dizziness, seizures. Seizures. So it's a nice note. Cardiovascular side effects, bradycardia. So this is the article of effectiveness of lidocaine. So it came out of Iran, actually. I think there was about 240 patients. It was randomized, prospective, lidocaine 1.5 milligrams per kg as a bolus versus morphine. And the outcome was pain score at 5 minutes, which I think is a little early. But this was in patients with renal colic. And this is one of the instances when Matov really recommends using lidocaine. And they actually found a benefit to using lidocaine over morphine. But that's 5 minutes. I think morphine really sets its effect in maybe around more 15 minutes, but, yeah. Next, I wanted to talk about Tylenol. But not Tylenol, acetaminophen IV. So this is something that, you know, I think everyone's heard about. I'm hesitant to order it because I'm like, oh, it's really costly. So I did the research for you. So as far as IV acetaminophen is concerned, so we know about COX-1, COX-2, it's how our NSAIDs work. Acetaminophen is not considered an NSAID because it doesn't have the anti-inflammatory aspect of it. However, in the early 2000s, they discovered COX-3, and it seems like IV acetaminophen, which came out in 2014, acts with that pathway in that way. So this is how we're dosing it, typical with PO, or the same as PO, 1 gram IV Q6, max 4 grams daily. So, benefits. It's quick onset, 15 minutes, long duration. It's been found to be as effective as morphine. In post-op patients, it's found to reduce their opiate use. The negatives is that you can't titrate it, right? So, if a patient has breakthrough pain, you're either going to give them NSAIDs or you're going to be giving them opiates. But, you know, you can still use it. Also, the cost. So, the cost per gram is $42. And that's because there is still a patent on it. Now, I was looking up Dilaudid, so I could be wrong, but this, with my research, 6 milligrams of Dilaudid was about $20. So we're redosing Dilaudid every 2-3 hours, and we're only redosing Tylenol every 6 hours. It's actually very comparative. So maybe we should be giving Tylenol instead.
Can you give an IM or sub-Q, or is it just IV?
You know what, I think you can give an IM, I'm not sure. That's the question.
It's a large volume of shit for IV.
That's true.
It's so IV, you get it.
Next, I want to talk about dexmedetomidine. So I actually don't have a lot of experience with Precedex. I know our EMIMs, you know, they use Precedex, they talk about it, and it seems really cool. You know, I haven't really used it much. But Matov is a big fan of dexmedetomidine. So it works as an alpha-2 central agonist, and this is actually how clonidine works. But it's 8 times more potent as far as analgesia is concerned, in comparison to clonidine. I didn't even know clonidine had an analgesic effect. Now I feel less badly about only offering clonidine to our heroin patients, but it does. It does. It has an analgesic effect, but Prestex has a much more potent analgesic effect. This is how you're going to be dosing it as a bolus, and you can also provide it as an infusion. And everyone talks about this, and Mickey talks about this, the EMIMs talk about this, because it provides some sedation, some analgesia without the respiratory depression. Now, Prestex is great because you can administer it in every way. You can administer in IV, IM, PO, intranasal, intra-articular, every way possible. It's mostly been studied as an adjunct therapy, though, so like kind of an add-on, just something of note. The cons of using Prestex, bradycardia and hypotension, but that's supposedly remedied if you're slowly infusing it. And then the cost. I believe that it's gone generic recently, so it might not be an issue. And then propofol. so good, right? I love playing with propofol. I think propofol, I like using propofol or administering to patients. Propofol is really great. For the juniors or for the seniors, use it for conscious sedation. Propofol, use ketamine, et cetera. Use as many of these medications as you possibly can. I'm not going to really talk about propofol because I don't think it really extends to pot A for us, right? We're not going to be like bolusing sicklers with propofol. But it is just an adjunct to remember. And then I just want to encourage you to check out Matov's website. So it's painfree-e.com, and he has tons of protocols. He doesn't have any lectures, but he has PowerPoints. You can read up on all these adjuncts and all these alternatives. He also has his Twitter feed on his website, and I don't use Twitter, I don't tweet. However, he puts out he retweets a lot of papers. And if you're interested in this pain management, the ER, etc., I'm sure you want to be reading what he's reading. So it was very useful during my research for this lecture. And then before I take any of your comments, because I would love to hear from you guys, I just wanted to first mention as well, I wanted to end this lecture with his sickle cell protocol. But they don't have a sickle cell protocol. He recommends using dexmedetomidine, using Tylenol IV, obviously, if you can get a line, and using ketamine for the sickle cell population. But even he admits that the sickle cell population is very difficult because of their tolerance and also because of their preference for certain medications, namely opiates. With that said, I did email Sally Bogosh, who is doing her first year fellowship at MAMO. And in 6 months, she said she cared for a handful of sickle cell patients. Not even two handfuls, actually no, not even a handful, less than a handful of sickle cell patients, and they all responded to NSAIDs. So what that tells me is, even if they did have a protocol, it probably wouldn't apply to our population. With that said, I think what we're doing at Downstate for the attendings who have adopted this PO-only kind of rule for themselves, and even in the weeks that I've been there, we've seen a lot of change. I hear a lot of great feedback from Sinner included, who instituted this a few weeks ago. And I don't think it's the answer. It's obviously not the answer because it's not comprehensive and we don't have addiction medicine involved and we don't have medicine involved. But if we don't act, no one will act. And unfortunately, it's an alternative that we have that somehow dissuades maybe the abuse of it. We're still providing analgesia, that's something to remember. We're still providing analgesia, we're still treating these patients. We're still doing the exam on these patients, but for some reason it's deterring kind of routine use of the ED for dilaudid maintenance. And with that, I just want to say thank you to everyone. This is my goodbye lecture. I'm done now. I just want to say thank you to everyone. If Dr. Smith were still here, I would say thanks. She was actually my mentor for 4 years before she was my PD. I feel very lucky, and thank you to Dr. Gernsheimer and all my PDs and my attendings and everyone who came before me and will come after me. It was a really great 4 years. It was difficult. Like, some people have seen me at my lows, but it was a very rewarding 4 years, and I feel like a better doctor and a better person having been a part of this program. So thank you.
Get opiates as children or before they even